not cash. Those are American troops. So he comes back to Moffat and says, Colonel, those are American troops, those are rebels, they are not Hessians. They are moving towards Princeton on our left flank. And Moffat takes a moment and then says, I want you to go check again to really be sure. Because, you know, he's got 600 men in motion at this point. He's got cannon. He's got ox-drawn baggage wagons. And if anyone here has ever dealt with oxen before, you know they have two speeds, slow and slower. Which is probably why they start at 5:30 and by 2 hours later they're like, 2.5 miles down the road. That's a bad ride for an ox. So Wilmot goes down again. Now I'm guessing that on his first pass, what he saw was Haussager's regiment going across. He's not observed by the Americans at that point. But his second trip, he says riflemen start shooting at him. And now there's no doubt that these are not Hessians. These are Americans. So he comes back and tells Moffat. Moffat decides, and he's got a couple of options. So one, he has orders to report to Trenton. If he continues marching down the post road and reports to Trenton, he can get in trouble because he's following his orders. His second option is to say, okay, I'm going to turn the entire column around, race back up to Princeton proper, just abandon those baggage wagons with the oxen, and we will get... We will get our troops laid out in Princeton itself to oppose the American attack. Now, Princeton has a couple of redoubts that have been built to protect it. They're all open back, sort of V-shaped structures. But that's still, earthworks gives you a lot of benefit and protection and defensive power over the rebels. He chooses option three, which is he is going to find a position from which he can stop the rebel advance on Princeton itself. He's going to cut that sawmill road, figuratively, not literally, by turning his force around, going back up the post road, and then turning off the post road on his right to go over an eminence and then attack whatever American troops he can find. Now, it's likely that, again, that first pass by Lieutenant Wilmot saw Haussager's column going up and over. The second pass probably caught Mercer's brigade, because we know that Mercer's brigade had one full rifle regiment and the remains of at least another, if not two others, with it. So that would explain why their riflemen were firing at Wilmot. And that's the point at which the third set of wheels falling off the bus happens with this battle plan. So again, Haussager, number one, is supposed to go up and attack from the north. He doesn't do that. Two, Sullivan is supposed to go up the sawmill road and attack from the east. He does that. Three, Greene's brigade is supposed to go up the King's Highway. Well, Greene's brigade, or Greene's division, is actually led by Mercer's brigade. Hugh Mercer is an irascible 50-odd years old Scotsman. He has a long and poor relationship with the British Army. As a teenager, he is an assistant surgeon at the Battle of Culloden, which ended the Jacobite Rebellion. He is then graciously offered a free trip to America by virtue of the King's Majesty, along with several tens of thousands of other Scots. He ends up over here in America, sets up shop first in Pennsylvania, ends up fighting in the French and Indian War as a colonel of Pennsylvania Provincials. That's where he meets George Washington on the 1758 campaign against Fort Duquesne, now modern Pittsburgh. He ends up, after the war, getting a land grant, going down to Fredericksburg, Virginia, where again he's got a lot of interaction with Washington. He's an apothecary, and thus, when the Continental Army is being organized as early as 1775, Washington appoints Hugh Mercer as brigade commander because he figures this is a man that I can rely upon. And normally you can, except it's been a really long 10 days. Hugh's in a bad mood, and he decides that he does not want to stand around out in the cold waiting. And we really fault him for that. So he says, screw this. I'm not going to wait for these extra cannons to be moved across the Stony Brook. I'm going to start marching. Now, unfortunately, he's a little directionally challenged. So instead of going along the Stony Brook and getting on the post road to go up north into Princeton. He decides, what are the marching troops that I can see? Oh, it's Sullivan's division. They're going that way. I'm just going to follow them. So instead of coming up to cut an attack from the south and the southwest, Mercer's following Sullivan's division up the eastern route. And Jerry, gentlemen, I apologize, but Jerry, if you wouldn't mind standing up and standing in front of these fine gentlemen over here and showing the map so that pretty much everyone can see it. Now, how do we know where the Sawmill is? Because it's a disused.
Oh my God.
Later, it's unlikely that we're going to find many remnants of it. Now, you'll see that there's this dotted line starting at the bottom of the map and going up, that black line. That is the Sawmill Road, and this building is actually one of the reasons, or one of the features that we use to figure out where the Sawmill Road was located. This building's main front porch, as you see, is to our right. Now, there is no Mercer Road. Mercer Road that we know today is built in 1804 as a turnpike. This building, most buildings, face some kind of road or other communications pathway. So that leads us to believe that the Sawmill Road is running somewhere out there. And we'll see a similar thing once we get up to the Thomas Clark House. So I think Roger's pointing out the Quaker Meeting House now, Roger. That's where we are. We are here. And the Thomas Clark House, where we started off, is right up there. Thomas Clark House is our other piece of information on the Sawmill Road. We actually have what we think is a trace of the original roadbed up there back in the woods where it's not going to be plowed up anytime soon. But instead of having you all stand behind the Clark House and admire it, I'll give you the scoop on that here now. So the farms over which this battle is going to take place are the farms of two brothers, William Clark and Thomas Clark. William Clark's house does not survive. Thomas Clark's house does. That's our other surviving witness structure before battle. It's built around 1771. The Clarks are a Quaker family who have roots in the community going back to the 1690s. And as you'll see when we walk by it relatively directly, the Clark house is facing in this direction. So again, combining the facing of the buildings with remnant of the road trace, we have a decent indication of where that road runs, as well as relying somewhat on a handful of other sources and a very advanced GIS computer viewshed analysis of all of this business. So, as you see on the dotted line there, Sullivan's division, by this point in time, is well along that road. They're moving up towards the north and
They're
moving along in that direction. And Mercer's brigade at this point in time is just starting off from around the area of the Quaker Meeting House where we're sitting today. And again, 5,000 guys, 5,500 guys, that's a lot of people. So trying to understand that scale is somewhat challenging. We have 70 odd in this group. So that's maybe one official company strength. Now, these soldiers who are attacking Princeton, not the German regiment in Philadelphia, were out of the place. This is a big mix of troops. So General John Sullivan's division, which of course is moving on up into town, not quite there yet, is mostly New England troops, several brigades of New England soldiers from all over the Northeast there. Green's division, even though he himself is Rhode Island, officially has Smallwood's Maryland Regiment with it and a Pennsylvania Rifle Regiment with it. However, as some of you may know, for the first couple of years of the war, actually right up until December of 1776, so the first 2 years, the American Army recruits annually. What that means is you raise an army for 1775, everyone enlists for 1775. On December 31st, 1775, everyone goes home. You're free. That's great. Until you have to fight in 1776, and you have to do it all over again, raising units from scratch, because not everyone who decided that fighting in 1775 was a good idea will still think that after the fights that they encounter in that year. So in 1776, again, You recruit an army from scratch. All of their enlistments end on December 31st, 1776. This is theoretically one of the reasons why Washington moved the non-occupied Clinton, is to have as much of his army as he could be here in conflict with the enlistment. He tells them that Congress has authorized an additional cash bounty for anyone who re-enlists. Of course, that's going to be paid paper money, not quite so useful then as it is now. And he manages to get a significant portion of his army to re-enlist. However, because officially the old army no longer exists on paper, this new army has been reorganized. You also have a lot of units that most of their men say, you know what, we've had enough, we're going home, where they've already gone home over the course of the 1776 campaign. So at this juncture, on January 3rd, 1777, from what we can tell in the primary source material, Mercer's brigade has effectively swallowed up all of these other odds and sods troops. So in addition to the regiments that are officially with his brigade, he seems to also have, judging from the surviving accounts, a pretty good leavening of New England troops, including the remnants of Durkee's Connecticut regiment, which is fought around 1776. We have one account from them by Sergeant R. that is pivotal for understanding what Mercer's brigade does in this battle. They also have some Virginia troops, for example, the 6th Virginia, which is there in linen hunting shirts. So imagine being outside in this weather wearing linen, which is a great idea if it's July 1776.